Good morning, everyone. My name is Cherie Eriks, and I am an attorney in our labor and employment group. I practice in our Fort Lauderdale office, and it is a pleasure to be speaking with you today as we examine the first 100 days of the Trump administration with an eye on labor and employment issues. A little background on me, I am originally from Seattle, Washington, and I could not be more pleased with my decision to escape the rain. I've been told they have a record rainfall these last few months, and I am now looking out of my window and seeing blue skies and sunshine, and I am very pleased that I'm giving this webinar from Fort Lauderdale. As a member of the LNE group, I investigate and defend clients against wage and hour and employment discrimination claims. I also counsel clients on employment policies and handbooks and negotiate and enforce employment contracts and the like. A few housekeeping notes before we get started. As an attendee, you can submit questions in the question box that's located, I believe it's a purple box on your screen. I will likely take questions at the end depending on the flow of the presentation, but please feel free to submit questions, and if I do not get to all of the questions, our awesome rockstar technology team will send me those questions after the webinar has concluded, and I promise to answer any questions that I don't get to during the presentation today. Also, a copy of the PowerPoint will be provided following the webinar, and there is also a survey available to you to fill out during the presentation at any time and also at the conclusion of the webinar. Your feedback is greatly appreciated, so please take some time to fill out the brief survey if once that link is circulated. Thank you very much for taking the time to attend this webinar, and let's get started. So why are we talking about the first 100 days? Well, this is a remnant of Franklin D. Roosevelt's tenure. He is said to have had the most impressive 100 days in office and sort of set the standard by which all other presidents are measured. There are interesting articles online examining the history of this 100 days thing, but in essence, it's a catchy way to look at a president's effectiveness during the first part of a president's administration, and can also provide a snapshot for people to examine a president's ability and willingness to keep campaign promises. It's also important because President Trump used the first 100 days language during his campaign. His contract with the American voter laid out a roadmap of sorts for what he sought to accomplish in his first 100 days. In this presentation, we will sort of do a 30,000-foot level examination of what has transpired over the last, I guess, 90-something days. I believe day 100 is Saturday or the tail end of this week. So we're at 90-something days here. We're going to do what I call a 30,000-foot level examination. This is a high-level inquiry into some of the issues that have been raised in the last 90-something days. We could take, way more than 1 hour discussing any one of these topics, and so this will be a high-level overview, but hopefully you will find it helpful and informative. We will look at President Trump's appointments, his executive orders, and his regulatory and legislative priorities. Switching to appointments, as you may recall from a civics class back in middle school or high school, the president has the power to nominate and appoint certain people. Some of those people require Senate confirmation, while others do not. We will focus here on Attorney General Jeff Sessions, Supreme Court Justice Neil Gorsuch, the nominee for Department of Labor Secretary Alex Acosta, and the chairs of the National Labor Relations Board and the EEOC. Attorney General Jeff Sessions was sworn in as the 84th Attorney General of the United States on February 9th, 2017. He is an Alabama guy. He was U.S. Attorney for the Southern District of Alabama. He was Alabama's Attorney General, and he served as senator for Alabama since 1996. He was confirmed on, like I said, February 9, 2017, in what is a some would consider a highly politicized confirmation hearing. He was confirmed by a vote of 52-47. As Attorney General, Mr. Sessions runs the Department of Justice, and he is the Chief Law Enforcement Officer and Chief Lawyer for the United States government. From a law enforcement perspective, in the first 100 days, we have noticed two key areas of emphasis impacting labor and employment. The first is immigration. He has directed the U.S. attorneys to step up prosecution of immigration cases. This is a big focus for Attorney General Sessions. When he was a senator, he focused on immigration issues, and he has carried that over into his tenure as Attorney General. He is an advocate for the mandatory use of E-Verify. When he was a senator, he has sponsored legislation to make E-Verify mandatory. For those of you who don't know, E-Verify is a free web-based system that allows businesses to determine employment eligibility of new hires by basically submitting information from a new hire's I-9 form and submitting that in the Social Security Administration, and USCIS determine whether the information matches their government records and they confirm authorization to work. E-Verify is not currently mandatory unless you are a federal contractor or an employer in a few states. I believe those are Arizona and Mississippi. Also, some states require public contractors and state agencies to use E-Verify, but it is not mandatory on a broad scale. There is legislation pending to make E-Verify mandatory, and if that passes, we would expect the Department of Justice under Attorney General Sessions to, as the enforcement arm of the federal government, to ramp up prosecutions of employers not using E-Verify. The other issue that we have been able to glean from the first 100 days that may impact labor and employment as particular to Attorney General Sessions is he has hinted at more aggressive enforcement of federal laws against recreational marijuana. This signals a reversal of an Obama-era non-enforcement policy. Under the Obama administration, President Obama said, basically, we don't have the resources at the federal level to police and investigate and crack down on the recreational use of marijuana, and so we're going to leave that to the states. Sessions has hinted at a more aggressive enforcement policy, so sort of returning back to the mantra that it's illegal under federal law. So this has an impact, we think, particularly in states where recreational use has been legalized. In certain states like Colorado, there are statutes on the books that say something to the effect of you cannot penalize an employee for any off-duty conduct that is legal. And when you had the federal government who had a non-enforcement policy, whether official or unofficial, and you had it legalized in the state, that kind of made things complicated for employers for enforcing their drug testing and workplace policies. So now that the federal government has recommitted to enforcement, at least under Attorney General Sessions, we could see, employers in those states where recreational marijuana has been legalized sort of be able to double down on their drug testing and workplace policies now that the federal government has decided to move away from their non-enforcement policy. Next up is a very important person. They're all very important, but this is important to us lawyers because Supreme Court Justice Neil Gorsuch was sworn in as the 113th Supreme Court Justice on April 10, 2017, filling a vacancy that was left by Justice Scalia after he passed away. Justice Gorsuch previously sat on the 10th Circuit U.S. Court of Appeals. He was also a high-level employee with the Department of Justice, focusing on constitutional law, civil rights, and environmental regulation. I note here on the slide that his mother was the first woman to head the EPA, and so I imagine his childhood was very interesting with all of those environmental terms, and he probably recycled before anybody else was doing that. He also was an attorney at a DC law firm with a specialization in antitrust, telecommunications, and securities fraud litigation. He clerked for Justices Kennedy and White, and he's a Harvard law grad, and he actually is classmates with President Obama. He is considered to be by most an originalist or a textualist, so he's following right there in the footsteps of Justice Scalia, adhering to a belief in the intent of the founders of the U.S. Constitution. So he's described as reliably conservative. He's looking at the text and applying sort of what did the founders mean, what would the founders say based on a particular legal issue that he would be presented. He's also said to have a propensity to support religious freedom. Hobby Lobby is a big case that involved the 10th Circuit while he was sitting on the bench. Hobby Lobby, just very briefly, I'm sure you guys all know, this was a case where the Supreme Court reviewed and upheld a decision rendered by the 10th Circuit involving application of the Religious Freedom Act. And the 10th Circuit had applied this language to corporations. So the text of the act prohibits the government from substantially burdening a person's free exercise of religion unless there is a compelling governmental interest. And Hobby Lobby and other companies sued to stop enforcement of regulations that were issued by the Department of Health and Human Services after passage of the Affordable Care Act because those rules had required employers to include in their group health plans coverage for certain contraceptive methods that have been approved by the FDA. And Hobby Lobby argued that its owners, the owners of Hobby Lobby as a privately held corporation, had a sincere Christian belief that life begins after conception and that it would violate their religious rights to facilitate access to contraceptive drugs. And the 10th Circuit had ruled that the businesses were persons under the act and that the regulations had burdened their exercise of religion. And the Supreme Court agreed in a 5-4 opinion and held that the act applies to regulations that govern the activities of closely held for-profit corporations. So people look to this Hobby Lobby decision to sort of to analyze Justice Gorsuch's propensity for supporting religious freedom. I think there was a case that has already been argued since he's been newly appointed to the bench dealing with religious freedom, and they suspect that he's going to continue that while he's on the bench. He has also been a critic of courts handing too much power to federal agencies that enforce labor and employment laws, and this will directly impact all of you as we look at the proper role of agencies and the proper role of these enforcement hands, the people, the agencies charged with enforcing the laws, how deferential are courts supposed to be to these agencies? He's a critic of handing too much power over to them. One labor and employment case I'd like to highlight that is set to be heard during this term, 2017 term for the Supreme Court, is National Labor Relations Board versus Murphy Oil. And this is a case where the Supreme Court is going to decide whether arbitration agreements with collective or class action waivers will violate the National Labor Relations Act. And if these arbitration agreements are enforceable under the Federal Arbitration Act, we expect Justice Gorsuch to possibly if this would be a split decision 5-4 during the Scalia days, it may be a similar sort of trajectory here. So it remains to be seen. We don't know how Justice Gorsuch will land on this, but it'll be interesting to follow. The next person is President Trump's nominee for Department of Labor Secretary, Alex Acosta. He was nominated after fast food executive Andy Puzder withdrew. His confirmation proceedings have moved to the full Senate, and at the time that I prepared this presentation, there had been no hearing set. But yesterday, Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell's office said that a vote may come this week. So we may have a new confirmed Department of Labor Secretary this week. Baker Donelson will, of course, inundate your inboxes with updates if that happens, but that's something to keep in mind that could take place this week. Mr. Acosta is a Harvard grad, undergrad and law school. He clerks for Justice Alito while Justice Alito was on the Third Circuit. He was previously a member of the National Labor Relations Board, and he has significant labor experience. He served as Assistant Attorney General for the Civil Rights Division of the Department of Justice. He was U.S. Attorney for the Southern District of Florida, where I practice down here. And he is currently the Dean of Florida International University's College of Law. Colleagues describe Mr. Acosta as balanced and an independent thinker, pro-free market, pro-free enterprise. These are all buzzwords that make employers very, very happy. He was confirmed on three other occasions in the prior experiences that I highlighted. Some of those were subject to Senate confirmation. So many think that his nomination will be confirmed by the Senate with no major hiccups. I know that there were some members of the committee who were concerned about some of his answers during the first proceeding, but we do not suspect that there will be major hiccups with his confirmation. He's kind of been through this process a couple of times. His priorities are to be determined. During his confirmation hearing, he basically promised to follow the executive actions of President Trump as his boss. He is, you know, the one arm of the executive branch, and he is, you know, appointed by President Trump, and so he views that relationship as sort of making sure he is following through with the principles and the guidelines as established by President Trump. Many think that he will review regulations with an eye for whether they have gone too far. That's been a lot of criticism with the prior administration's Department of Labor, and EEOC has been, you know, these administrative agencies have really been doing more than just enforcement. They've been doing rule interpretation or interpretation of law, and so we suspect that Mr. Acosta will be reviewing regulations that were adopted or set to be implemented with an eye for, is this the proper function of the Department of Labor as an enforcement agency? Along the same lines, we think that he, or I guess with the Department of Labor being headed by Mr. Acosta, it is unlikely that the DOL will pursue appeal of the final overtime rule injunction. If you all remember, the final overtime rule was published in May of 2016, or it was issued, the final rule was issued, and it revised the overtime exemptions. It basically doubled the salary threshold for determining whether someone is exempt from the overtime regulations, and it provided for automatic updates to the minimum salary every 3 years. And it was set to take effect December 1st, 2017, but on November 22nd, before that date, a district court in Texas entered a nationwide preliminary injunction, basically preserving the status quo, preserving the existing salary threshold until the court can make a final determination on the Department of Labor's authority to enter into this final rule. On December 1st, the DOL, under Obama's appointee, Secretary Thomas Perez, he appealed that injunction to the Fifth Circuit, and the Fifth Circuit has recently granted a request for an extension of time to file a reply brief, so they're still in the briefing phase, and a reply brief is not due until May 1st, 2017. So the reasoning cited by the DOL for seeking the extension was to allow incoming leadership to assess basically the issues. So that gives Mr. Acosta time to get up to speed if he is confirmed and decide whether he wants to pursue the appeal of the injunction. He has stated that he's open to updating the overtime regulations. So we could see future changes to the overtime rules, but I would be shocked if If he is confirmed, I would be shocked if he decides to proceed with the appeal of the nationwide injunction or if he seeks salary threshold change that was as significant as the proposed or as the final rule. He is equally unlikely to pursue appeal of the persuader rule injunction. If you recall, the persuader rule was something that had all of us legal types of law firms in a panic. It required us to publicly disclose to the DOL any work that the firm did for employers surrounding union organization efforts. And the rule effectively eliminated the exemption from disclosure for legal advice, and lawyers and employers were very concerned about its implementation. On November 16, 2016, however, a federal district court in Texas issued a nationwide permanent injunction on that persuader rule. And we suspect that Mr. Acosta is not going to pursue appeal of that injunction. We could be surprised, but that's sort of what the thinking is based on the statements he's made about the proper role of the DOL. Acosta finally is not likely to implement the fiduciary rule as it's written. We'll talk about the fiduciary rule in just a minute because that was subject to executive action, which we'll get to in just a second. Next up, we have Acting NLRB Chair. This is Philip Misamara. I have half a mind to ask for a volunteer to tell me how to pronounce his name. I was on a few panel presentations or witnessed a few panel presentations where the moderator pronounced his name several different ways. So it could be Misamara or Misamara, but I'm just going to go with Misamara. So Mr. Misamara was named acting chairman of the NLRB on January 23, 2017 by President Trump. At the time that I prepared this slide, he was acting chair, but last Friday, President Trump announced that he will pick him to serve as chairman of the NLRB. So he'll drop the acting title and just be the chair. He was an Obama appointee, first sworn in as a Republican member of the NLRB on August 7th, 2013, and he was a previous law partner with a firm in Chicago. He is considered by many to be academic. He was a senior fellow at the Wharton Business School. He's co-authored several labor law books. I know there are a lot of people in academia who like his involvement with the NLRB because he brings with him an academic perspective. Some interesting things will be going on with the NLRB under the Trump administration, in part because we've got two democratically held seats and two vacant seats that are expected to be filled by President Trump. So this obviously creates a real opportunity for a shift to a Republican or conservative majority on the NLRB. And so we could see a shift on some major decisions under the prior iteration of the NLRB before these new, before the vacant seats get filled or the democratically held seats get filled. So we've got class action waivers, which I've already talked about briefly, where the Supreme Court may actually decide this issue. But we've got the D.R. Horton case that Misamara was a critic of how the NLRB came out on the D.R. Horton case. We've got the joint employer standard that was adopted in Browning Ferris Industries case. This was the standard adopted by the NLRB that was a surprise to a lot of people because it found a joint employer relationship in a franchisee context that surprised a lot of people, was a deviation from well, long-regarded precedent with the NLRB, and Misamara was a critic of that decision as well. We've got a lot of activity with social media and handbook policies in the last few years from the NLRB and how those policies infringe on concerted activity rights under the National Labor Relations Act. So if we have a Republican administration who is nominating or filling the vacant seats And if we have the democratically held seats that get, people get appointed to those who are more conservative in thinking, we suspect that there could be changes to how the NLRB approaches these social media and handbook cases. There's also an issue of quickie union elections, where the time was shortened from 38 to 23 days. And that is another issue that could change, that we could see major shifts in the next few years as the vacancies get filled and the makeup of the board changes. Interestingly, there were no budget cuts proposed for the NLRB in the president's fiscal year 18 budget. I forgot to mention there are significant budget cuts for the Department of Labor. So that will also have a hand in how they operate, in part because we suspect that it's not going to be as litigious. They're not going to have the resources, honestly, to be as aggressive as they may have been in the last couple of years. The NLRB doesn't have budget cuts, but we think the makeup of the NLRB could change, and that could change the opinions of the NLRB even without the budget cuts. We have a new acting chair of the EEOC, the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission. On January 25th, President Trump named her as Victoria Lipnick as acting chair of the EEOC. She was an Obama appointee, first sworn in as a Republican commissioner in April 2010, and her term has been renewed until July 1st, 2020. Past experiences include a stint with the Department of Labor, where she was Assistant Secretary of U.S. Labor, or Assistant Secretary of Labor for Employment Standards, which heads the Wage and Hour Division. And she also served as in-house counsel for many, many years for the Labor and Employment Matters for the United States Postal Service. Some of the priorities we can glean from the first 100 days with the new acting chair, Ms. Lipnick, we have, we know that she's one of two commissioners to vote against interpreting Title VII to prohibit sexual orientation discrimination. So EEOC has long had guidance that included sexual orientation discrimination, even though lots and lots of cases have came out to the contrary and said Title VII, by its express terms, does not prohibit sexual orientation discrimination. Courts have made workarounds where they have included, gender stereotyping and things like that to cover these kinds of cases. But sexual orientation itself, they have long said, is not, our courts have routinely said, is not included in Title VII. The EEOC has basically said, I hear you, but I disagree. The acting chair, the current acting chair, is one of two commissioners who voted against interpreting it that way. And I'll also talk about a case that kind of adds a wrinkle to all of this, because it's the first case, basically, it's the first case that has ruled that sexual orientation discrimination is included in Title VII, and we'll get to that in later in this presentation. She has expressed publicly that there should be a focus on the proper role of the EEOC as a regulatory enforcement agency. So similar comments made by the nominee for the Department of Labor. It's looking at what is the role of the EEOC. The EEOC is supposed to be enforcing the laws. And there has been criticism of the litigious nature of the EEOC, as well as their legal interpretations of things, interpreting the law instead of enforcing the law. And so this could signal a less litigious EEOC, which employers would love to also hear about that. Her comments about the proper role of the EEOC can be interpreted as a signal of maybe more conciliation, more focus on compliance, and less litigation, less rulemaking and lawmaking, really. She believes that the commission should not shift priorities from the existing strategic enforcement plan. That plan has been adopted from 2017 to 2021. In the strategic enforcement plan, there are two areas. We've got equal pay, And that's equal pay along gender. That's equal pay along race and ethnicity, all of the protected statuses. It's not just looking at gender. So that is, we will likely see more emphasis on this equal pay issue because that's included in the strategic enforcement plan. We also have in the strategic enforcement plan what they're calling issues related to complex employment relationships. So we're talking temp workers, staffing agencies, independent contractors, sort of the modern day 21st century employer issues. The EEOC and their strategic enforcement plan has said that they're going to focus on these issues, and so we may see continued focus on independent contractors. There is this idea that maybe independent contractors will be even more of a issue and something that everyone is interested in because it involves taxes. I mean, if you're not, withholding taxes, then states and federal government, everybody's not getting their money. And so it's very possible that these kinds of complex employer-employee relationship issues will be what the EEOC focuses on because they may not have a lot of opposition to that focus from state actors who want to see more tax revenue and the IRS. In that sphere. She has signaled that she is open to reevaluating the EEO-1 reporting requirements that are set to take effect in March 2018. There are new reporting requirements, that are set to take effect in March 2018. The EEO-1 reporting requirements, of course, you know that a report is mandatory for employers who have 100 or more employees. And the revised requirements require employers to report pay data. So in addition to all the demographic data, the EEOC is asking for employers to report pay data and hours worked arguably to help with their strategic enforcement plan where they're looking at equal pay. And so the data is supposed to be populated with pay data reflected in box one of the employee's W-2 forms. And it has come under scrutiny because of the administrative hassles associated with collecting this data, the accuracy of using box one of the W-2 to adequately reflect compensation paid. There are a number of issues, and the acting EEOC chair has signaled that she's open to reevaluating the changes to those reporting requirements. Like the NLRB, there are no budget cuts proposed for the EEOC in the President's fiscal year 18 budget, at least as that budget was previously done. And so we suspect that a lot of the changes will not be financial, but because there's a changing of the guard. So overall, what can we expect from the Trump DOL, the NLRB, the EEOC, all of these agencies that employers interact with the most? What we will likely see is a shift away from an emphasis on rulemaking and rule and legal interpretation and an emphasis on compliance with existing regulations. Many will argue that federal agencies under the Obama administration were aggressive about interpreting the law, that the agencies were active in trying to create law and not just enforcing existing law. And one thing that all of President Trump's appointees have in common, Judge Gorsuch, the DOL nominee, and the acting chair of the EEOC have all said this in different ways. They are critical of what they see as agency overreach, and they're keenly aware of the proper role of executive agencies as the enforcement arm of the government. So we could see more conciliation efforts, more emphasis on compliance, working with employers to try to resolve compliance-related issues, less litigiousness, especially with the DOL and the budget cuts that have been proposed for them. The other takeaway is that it's kind of too early to tell how things are going to shake out. The entire executive branch, back on January 20th, was ordered to basically hold off the wait and see, because his appointments hadn't been confirmed. He didn't want, there was a flurry of activity towards the end of the Obama administration, and he didn't want these agencies rushing to implement things before he could get his people in place. And so on January 20th, he sent a memorandum to all of the agencies basically telling them to sit tight. So to the extent allowed by law, they're not supposed to move forward with any new rules or interpretive guidance or regulations that were approved under the prior administration until a new agency head has been appointed and confirmed. So we will likely see a status quo. We'll see the agencies hold off on implementing any rules that were passed or anything that was that was supposed to be implemented towards the tail end of the Obama administration or beginning of the Trump administration. And then we'll likely see more efforts to look at compliance and less lawmaking on the part of the executive agencies. Switching gears here to executive orders, President Trump has signed a number of executive orders. I'm not going to go through all of them, in part because there are only a few that have the direct impact on labor and employment that we can fit into an hour-long presentation. So we've got his executive order related to immigration, the Protecting the Nation from Foreign Terrorist Entry into the United States. That was the first executive order that was issued January 27, 2017. It was signed by President Trump, and it immediately suspended admission of all refugees for 120 days and the admission of Syrian refugees indefinitely. It also included language offering preferential status to persecuted religious minorities, who a lot of people interpreted that language to be persecuted Christian minorities in predominantly Muslim parts of the world. And so once the refugee program resumed, that the preferential status for persecuted religious minorities would be implemented. It also had a prohibition on admission of all citizens from 7 designated countries. This was both immigrant and non-immigrant, so people who had visas, either immigrant or non-immigrant, no matter what, these 7 countries were designated there was a prohibition on admission. So we have Iraq, Iran, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, Syria, and Yemen. These were countries of concern under the Obama administration, and the Trump administration thought that it would help to ease the sort of the legal concerns with this, based on the fact that the countries themselves were chosen based on designations by the prior administration. The State Department also issued an order revoking immigrant and non-immigrant visas for the citizens of the 7 countries. And the White House was questioned about whether this executive order would apply to permanent residents, and they eventually clarified that it would not apply. Legal challenges were swift on the first iteration of the executive order. There were challenges filed in Brooklyn, federal courts throughout the country, and on February 3rd, the state of Washington filed suit in federal court and sought a nationwide injunction. The federal district court in Seattle issued a temporary restraining order blocking the executive order's provisions, the 90-day suspension of entry, its limits on accepting certain refugees, and the religious minorities priority. And then on February 5th, the Ninth Circuit declined to set aside the injunction. So President Trump's administration had appealed the federal district court's restraining order, and the Ninth Circuit declined to set it aside. The executive order was then revised on March 6th, and it was had a few major changes. One of the changes was that it suspended the refugee program for 120 days, so like similar to the previous suspension, but it removed the indefinite suspension on Syrian refugees, and it also removed the persecuted religious minorities preference. The revised order removed Iraq from the countries of concern, and it reinstituted the suspension for the remaining six countries. So now it was six when it was seven before, but it kept the 90 days. The revised order specifically carved out exceptions. So this was not in the first order, but when they revised it, they carved out exceptions to clarify basically people's concerns about how broad is this scope. So it carved out exceptions for U.S. permanent residents, people who already held a valid visa, dual citizens who were traveling on their other passport to and from the United States, people already granted travel authorization, such as asylum, refugee status. It was trying to sort of carve out for those who may have vested rights in whatever visas or travel authorizations or passports or travel rights that these people had. It also established factors agencies should consider in issuing visas. And it provided, instead of an immediate implementation, so the first order said all this has to be done immediately. And the revised order provided a 10-day implementation period. Not surprising, the revised ban was also challenged in federal court. And right now we've got two cases with dueling timelines. We've got a federal district court in Hawaii who's issued a temporary restraining order. And the Trump administration has appealed that decision to the Ninth Circuit, who is set to hear the case on May 15th. And then we have a federal district court in Maryland who's issued a preliminary injunction on just a piece of it, the 90-day travel ban, the 90-day travel suspension. And the decision has been appealed to the Fourth Circuit, who will hear the case on May 8th. So within the next few weeks, we may have movement on the executive order as related to immigration. And no matter how they decide, even if there's not a conflict, we expect an appeal to the U.S. Supreme Court. So whether President Trump prevails on this issue or whether the states or the litigants prevail on this issue, we'll likely see an appeal to the U.S. Supreme Court. This is a big deal. Another immigration-related executive order was President Trump's Buy American and Hire American executive order on April 18th. And it directed the Department of Labor, Justice, Homeland Security to take prompt action to curb fraud and abuse in what the administration referred to as fraud and abuse in the guest worker program. This is particularly targeted to the H-1B visa program. And that is the non-immigrant visa that allows U.S. employers to temporarily employ foreign workers in specialty occupations like physical sciences, social sciences, biotech, chemistry. These are people who have specialized knowledge, usually a bachelor's degree or higher, and a sponsoring employer. And in all practicality, it's used for technology companies. The majority of the recipients are technology workers. There is a cap on the H-1B visas. I believe it's $65,000 in the fiscal year with 20,000 additional spots for foreign nationals who hold master's or higher degrees. And this particular executive order directs the agencies to propose changes. So it's not known exactly what changes are in store, but President Trump is signaling to the administrative and to his legislative colleagues that he's looking to see reforms to the H-1B visa program. So this could signal a move away from the random lottery system. This could signal adjustments to the wage scale. This could signal increased charges for H-1B petitions. The executive order itself does not lay out what changes are proposed, but we know that he is looking for reforms administratively and also legislatively. And of course, this has the biggest impact on technology companies because that's the bulk of the people who do this. So what does this mean for employers? Ultimately, implementation of the executive order is kind of up for grabs. We've got, or you know, it's not exactly clear from the executive order itself what changes are in store, but you can sort of suspect that, or you can foresee that there will be changes, particularly to the H-1B visa program, because that's sort of what some people refer to as low-hanging fruit for the Trump administration. It's something that he can possibly see immediate or action quickly. With the changes in immigration, particularly with the H-1B visa program, he can't act alone, so he'll need congressional approval to take certain actions, like removing the lottery system or adjusting wages. But the main employer takeaway is to be mindful of this particular program. So for employers who have H-1B visa programs, who use that significantly, you'll want to be mindful of those changes because that's been a program that's been targeted by the president. And shameless plug time, Baker Donelson has a wealth of practitioners who know a whole lot more about immigration than I do. And I just highlighted one here, Robert Devine. He is head of Baker Donelson's immigration group. There's his contact information there. And there's the link or the web address for Baker Donelson's immigration folks. We also have healthcare. So in addition to immigration, we have healthcare as an area that is potentially going to have an impact on you as employers. On January 20th, right, the first day of the Trump administration, he signed this executive order on minimizing the economic burden of the Affordable Care Act. He said, it's the policy of my administration to seek the prompt repeal of the Affordable Care Act. And in the meantime, pending such repeal, it is imperative for the executive branch to take all actions consistent with the law to exercise authority when they can. So that means granting waivers when they can, deferring implementation of things when they can, granting exemptions, basically delaying the implementation as much as they possibly can of this act for those things that they can delay implementation of, and giving any waivers for costs, fees, tax penalties as authorized by law. What this means for employers is to be determined because the Affordable Care Act is still the law of the land. It's the Trump administration's goal to repeal the Affordable Care Act, but it is still the law of the land. So employers need to continue business as usual for now and look at this executive order as a signal of the administration's desire to take steps to repeal and replace the Affordable Care Act. And not too much more at this stage. There are no changes to the employer reporting obligations. There are no changes to the employer mandate. The waivers that were referred to in the executive order are not likely because the penalties for the employer mandate pieces are written into law. It's not the subject of discretion at this point for the agencies, and it's also a significant source of revenue. So, continue forth business as usual with respect to the Affordable Care Act until we see further efforts to repeal and replace the Affordable Care Act. And I think this might be my last shameless plug. This is our Baker Donelson healthcare experts. We have a lot of them, but these are two that I've highlighted who are in our labor and employment group. Their contact information is there. If you have specific questions about healthcare, Andrea Bailey Powers is our ERISA expert. She knows everything about the Affordable Care Act and its implementation and its effect on employers. And so you definitely reach out to these healthcare experts to the extent you have any specific health-related questions. But for now, you know, stay the course. We also, I alluded to this when I was talking about the Department of Labor's secretary, the fiduciary duty rule. The reason why we do not believe that this fiduciary duty rule will be implemented anytime in the near future is because of the executive order that President Trump signed requiring the Department of Labor to re-review the rule. So the fiduciary duty rule was published back in April of last year, and it required all investment advisors providing recommendations concerning investment policies or strategies to abide by the fiduciary duty standard, so the best interest of the client standard. And on February 3rd, 2017, President Trump signed a memorandum to the DOL stating that it was his belief that the fiduciary duty rule, by adoption of this best interest of the client or best fiduciary duty standard, may significantly alter the manner in which Americans can receive financial advice. So he directed the Department of Labor to re-review the rule and decide whether the rule has harmed or will harm investors, whether it will result in disruption or will cause an increase in litigation. And then the DOL is instructed to publish for notice and comment a proposed rule rescinding the fiduciary duty rule if there is a yes to any of those questions. It was originally scheduled to be phased in beginning April 10th, so a few weeks ago, but it's been delayed to June 9th, arguably so that the new Department of Labor head can get in there and decide what they're going to do with this thing. And I've already covered that. Just so you know, fiduciary duty rule, if implemented, impacts employers who are investment plan sponsors because of the interaction with ERISA. So that's why it really matters whether your investment advisors have a heightened fiduciary duty. Could mean that you, as an employer, could be susceptible to attack for not providing appropriate investment options for employees. So you want to keep track of implementation of the fiduciary duty rule. Just other L&E executive actions. I'm not going to go too far into there, but you know, there's a federal hiring freeze for civilian employees of the executive branch. There is a memorandum withdrawing the U.S. from the Trans-Pacific Partnership trade deal, which has an impact on labor folks in particular, because there were some labor standards that were included in that partnership trade deal that the U.S. is no longer a part of. And then there was an executive order requiring federal agencies to propose repeal of two existing regulations for each new one that they seek to implement. So this will affect, of course, the Department of Labor and all of the federal agencies who are proposing rulemaking, in that they're going to have to identify two existing regulations to be phased out if they want to seek implementation of any new rule. There is one executive order from the Obama administration I wanted to highlight that has been revoked, and it is the Fair Pay and Safe Workplaces Executive Order. And this required potential federal contractors with a contract of $500,000 or greater to disclose violations of federal and state labor and employment laws, to identify remedial action taken for violations and update disclosures every 6 months. President Trump did not revoke Executive Order 13672. So 13673 was the Fair Pay and Safe Workplaces. But President Obama had signed in tandem a separate executive order prohibiting contractors from discriminating on the basis of sexual orientation or gender identity. And that particular executive order was not revoked. So just the Fair Pay and Safe Workplaces one, the one requiring disclosure of federal and state labor and employment laws and executive orders, any violations of those, that was required to be disclosed, but not the prohibition on discriminating on the basis of sexual orientation. Shifting to regulatory priorities, there's not a lot that can be gleaned from the first 100 days. President Trump has been very busy in other avenues, but just a couple to highlight. We've mentioned sexual orientation discrimination a couple of times. You know, there are questions about whether adding sexual orientation and gender identity as a protected status is a priority of the Trump administration, and probably not. So we did not see a repeal of the executive order that I just mentioned prohibiting sexual orientation discrimination and federal contracting, and the EEOC views gender identity and sexual orientation as a protected status in its enforcement guidance, but the newly appointed chair, as I mentioned, dissented on this issue. Trump's Department of Justice and the Department of Education have rescinded certain transgender bathroom guidance for schools, which could signal a shift in the federal view on transgender issues. And there's and so there's reason to believe that this will not be a big push by President Trump and his administration to expand the notion of expand the class of folks who are included in Title VII who get those kinds of protections. There is a case which I told you I would mention. It's out of the Seventh Circuit, and it is the first appellate case to hold that sexual orientation discrimination is included in Title VII. So now there's a circuit split. There wasn't before. There is now. The Seventh Circuit has said it's included, and so stay tuned as the U.S. Supreme Court is probably going to weigh in on this now that there is a circuit split. Paid maternity leave may be a priority. This was something that was rolled out during the campaign. It's not a fully fleshed out policy. The proposal was to guarantee 6 weeks of paid maternity leave, whether it's full pay or a percentage of pay is to be determined, but there was the idea that this will be funded through the unemployment insurance program. This would apply to employers that do not offer paid maternity leave on their own. So that's one issue. The other issue is that it does not currently include paternity leave or provisions for non-birth or foster parents, other than, you know, sort of the FMLA, which offers unpaid leave for those purposes. So this is possibly a priority. This was something that he announced in conjunction with his daughter, Ivanka Trump, who has a special advisor role in his administration. So this could be something that they continue to focus on. And you just need to remember that state and local laws may require paid maternity and paternity leave. This OSHA overhaul slide here really just talks about some of OSHA's more controversial policies and procedures and possibly rolling back of those. The slides, again, will be circulated at the end if you're curious about that, but I'm going to skip over OSHA in the interest of conserving time. So we're going to now talk about legislative priorities, and I think we highlight two of them here. So we've got repeal of the Affordable Care Act, which we've talked about. On March 6th of 2017, we note that House Republicans have released the text of the American Health Care Act. So we saw a repeal of the Affordable Care Act's taxes and the individual and employer mandates. There was a replacement of the Affordable Care Act's subsidies and tax credits, and there was a phase out of the Medicaid expansion. That's what was included, in, among other things, in the American Health Care Act. On March 24th, the House pulled the American Health Care Act for a vote, but reports are indicating that House Republican leaders in the White House and everyone has recently resumed discussions on legislation to repeal the Affordable Care Act. So we could see more movement on this in the very near future. But remember, for now, the Affordable Care Act is the law of the land. There's also been, you may have heard this, the Congressional Review Act, and it's basically a procedural way for Congress to overrule regulations that were implemented within the last 60 legislative days of the prior administration. So the time for overturning those regulations, I think, ends shortly in May, but I will highlight some of the ones that have been overturned through the Congressional Review Act. So President Trump has signed bills over nullifying certain rules, one of them being OSHA's rule creating a duty to keep records of work-related injuries for 5 years. Originally, it was 6 months. OSHA implemented a new rule, and Congress has nullified that rule. President Trump has also signed a resolution nullifying the blacklisting rule that required contractors to disclose labor violations. So those are just two of the primary rules that have been overturned through the Congressional Review Act. And then lastly here, I have included just a list of meetings. President Trump has been busy. He's been meeting with business leaders and union leaders, small businesses, CEOs. He has participated in discussions on advancement of women entrepreneurs. met with manufacturing and health insurance CEOs. He is sort of signaling, I guess, keeping employers, and even unions involved as he proceeds in his administration. So there's a list of meetings that he has had with that are listed on his public calendar for you to take a look if you're interested. If you're involved in any of these organizations, then you can take a look and your organization will probably give you more information about the substance of that meeting. So it is now 12:30. I have went the entire hour and I have not yet answered any questions, so I promise to get to the questions. There are a few in the inbox here. So I will have responses to people who have asked questions shortly. Thank you guys very, very much. Baker Donelson, of course, will keep you updated with alerts and webinars. You know, make sure you're on our mailing list. There's my contact information there. I think, you know, the few takeaways that I can say, one, you know, stay the course. We're still in a transition period. And to the extent that we are going to see changes, they are going to be, one, from the DOL because of budgetary concerns, and also because there's a changing of the guard. There are people who are accepting leadership positions who are less litigious, who are interested in all of these agencies sort of getting back to their days of enforcement and less about rulemaking and interpreting the law. So thank you very much, and if you have any questions, definitely reach out.